Welcome, another Three Wells podcast. Another glorious sunny day. We're shooting from California. Our special guest, Mr. D himself from Papa and Barkley's with us today. And he's, you're up in Humboldt, aren't you, D?
Yep, I'm up in Humboldt.
All right, well, I don't know what the weather's like up there, but it's sunny down here. I'm sure it's sunny up there. But hey, what we're talking about with our special guest, CEO, correct?
Yeah.
Papa and Barkley. I think that's a pretty new jump up for you, is it not?
Yeah, just recently. Yeah. So, you know, thanks for having me. Like I said, my name is Guy Rocourt. I'm co-founder and now currently CEO of Papa and Barkley. I started as chief product officer. That is my passion, is making awesome products. And, you know, it's definitely the backbone of Papa and Barkley and the Papa and Barkley family of brands. Everything we do is solventless. Everything we do is clean label and fair trade to the extent that we can secure the supply chain. We're very focused on the most sustainable packaging. Aesthetics does take a second seat. And, you know, to consumers, you know, we do have to have packages that jump off shelf, but they have to be sustainable first, because I think that's more important to the consumer and more sustainable. Because eventually consumers will understand that, oh, my packaging may not be as shiny, but it's more sustainable and the right thing to do, because it just ends up in the garbage. What matters is what's inside. So yeah, you know, really happy to be progressing the mission at Papa and Barkley. And now at the helm, I'm able to just drive home those final value points, because I believe that with our first mover advantage, we not only have an obligation to our company and investors to create an awesome cannabis company, but we have an obligation to this industry to cement a cornerstone and a benchmark that really really shows and educates what's premium wellness and premium cannabis actually is.
So, man, I got to tell you, wow, because I know that wasn't scripted. That was great. I'm glad I'm recording it, because I got to write all that down. But a couple of things I want to highlight. One is congratulations on now leading the entire company. Well-deserved. I've known you for, a year, almost 2 years now. So I know you are in a position that is well-deserved. So good for you. The other thing that you said that I didn't know, because I look at the Papa and Barkley, and by the way, I should say to the audience, this is not a paid promotion. This is totally of Three Wells' own volition. We talk to great companies and we talk about great products all the time. And this is just bringing you, the audience, real info. I'm going to challenge Guy at times. I'm sure he'll challenge me back, but I wanted to put that out first before I say what I'm about to say, because it could come off sounding like a paid promo and it's not. But the one thing I've noticed about your products over the years is how nicely they were packaged, how beautifully designed and layout and informative they were. I didn't know you put sustainability first. I always wondered why, because I noticed that you use a lot of bamboo on the lids and not plastics and things like that. I had assumed it, but it was great to hear. So kudos to you. You're doing both. You're making it look good and you're making it good, period, for the planet. So nice job. I didn't know.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah.
So let's dive into the core topic for today, which is really about sleep. Because, you know, from my personal perspective, I can't tell you how many times someone has come to me and said, I can't sleep, and I recommend cannabis to them. And yes, I have recommended Papa Barkley products in the past, and I still do. And it's just been this phenomenal life changer. And I'll give you a very specific example. I had a neighbor of mine, and he came to me and I said, man, you look kind of tired. He said, yeah, you know, it's been 2 or 3 months. I cannot sleep. I've tried the Ambien. I've tried the NyQuil, all these things. I just, sure, they'll put me out, but I'm not rested. And I said, well, have you tried? And it was actually your tincture. And I said, have you tried this? And I gave him the specifics around it. We'll get into the specifics later. And within 3 days, he was sleeping like a baby. And he came to me and said, hey, man, you saved my life. And I should have said, I took credit, but I should have said, hey, no, man, it was Guy and Papa Barkley, but I took credit, full disclosure. But let's talk about sleep, right? So, and if we could start with, what is it and why cannabis helps you sleep? And then I want to get into one of the unique ingredients that I know you have in your product, which is CBN. I keep putting the D in there. But talk to us about sleep and cannabis.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'll start with a little bit of education because at Papa Barkley, we create products where I can speak about science education of cannabis and not the brand, and you're still going to find us, right? That's how we make products, just based on the best science and not anything further than that. So CBN is the cannabinoid broadly associated with sleep. And I know a lot of people are throwing out all these different cannabinoids. We only engage things that we can have at least previous anecdotal evidence or evidence that we have garnered ourselves. With CBN, it was pretty easy. For those who don't know, CBN is a natural degradant of THC. And we know that sleep is a side effect, or sleepiness, sedentary behavior, is a side effect of cannabis, right? A long-time side effect, which is a benefit. You know, if you have trouble sleeping, oh, guess what? This thing makes you sleepy. But what we don't know is because of prohibition, sleepiness and cannabis were even more intertwined because THC naturally degrades to CBN. So a lot of the original cannabis we got back in the day, if it was brown or looked oxidized, it was sleepy time. It was going to be couch lock. This notion that cannabis promotes that sleepy, sedentary behavior is primarily because in traditional market, we got older weed, oxidized weed, right? But we also know now, even as the compliant market started happening, you leave a bag of cannabis in the sun or you leave it out, it becomes oxidized, it's more sleepy. Well, what is that? That is CBN being produced. So now, as we start to get into value-added products, we know definitively that some measure of CBN promotes sedentary or sleep behavior, right? So now that has kind of been anecdotally proved. So unlike other cannabinoids that people are trying to push in and they don't really know what they do, we can start to look at a body of anecdotal evidence. Historically, we did do significant in-home use tests with our particular sleep formula because we also do believe in ratios. So our sleep formula happens to be 2-4-1, two parts CBD, four parts THC, and one part CBN. I can talk about how we got to those ratios to make sure that it was super effective, right? But now that we understood that CBN molecule, that's what has to go into your sleep formulation. Okay, and we know it works because it is that natural degradant of THC or older weed, older cannabis or sleepy time weed comes from that, right? And so when we come out with these formulations, we're like, okay, if we put a little bit of CBN in it, it will encourage that sedentary behavior. CBD also is a relaxing substance. THC by itself is not, I think, is more neutral in terms of sleep v non-sleep, and combined with the right terpenes and the other ratio will be the difference between focusing somebody that has ADHD, right, uplifting the creative mind, or when combined with CBN, kind of lowering your thought pattern down, right? Because remember, cannabis works on not only mind, but body, or body and mind, right? And so folks who usually have trouble sleeping has nothing to do with their bodies being tired. It usually has to do with a mind that is not shutting off, racing, constantly having an internal dialogue. And cannabis works two ways. It slows that down, and it also flips them to be more positive. Those are facts, right? So when you think about people that are depressed, it's not, depression is this reinforcing echo chamber of bad thoughts, of you just looking at the dark side. Right? Your dialogue is going and going and going. Sleep people need to shut it down. Depressed people need to flip it so it's just a little bit more rosy colored. Cannabis does that pretty naturally. We just need to tweak those ratios, right? So in coming out with the sleep formula, I was confident on the CBN, right? Confident on the ratio as we tested it. And then it was about changing the paradigm. A lot of folks want to be like, oh, you're a gummy provider, you're a chocolate provider, you're a tincture provider. It's all wellness to us. And so when we come out with these need state suites, it's across all categories. So our sleep suite is not just a gummy, not just a tincture, but it's a gummy, a tincture, a chocolate, and a capsule, so that however you partake in cannabis, it's present there for you. Would I come out with a CBN sleep or vape product that's just older, an older inhalable? Probably not, because I don't think that anybody wants to smoke old weed, but we can process the cannabinoids to present the CBN in that way. So that's how we came up with the suite of sleep products.
So talking about validation, I noticed you guys talk about a California study that was done on sleep. Tell us about that, what they found, and why, because I know you even have it on your site. Why is that?
Yeah. So, you know, we started what we call IHUTs, or in-home use tests, a long time ago. We are blessed on our scientific advisory boards to have some serious players, Dr. Mitch Earlywine, you know, who's a longtime cannabis advocate and author. Also, Dr. Oren Davinsky, who wrote the book on childhood epilepsy and was the lead investigator on the Epidiolex trial. So we've been able to, you know, really understand how traditional science and data research works. But of course, even here in Humboldt, trying to partner with universities, trying to get typical researchers to engage with us, they often balk because we were talking about the world we live in. We live in a very litigious, insurance-driven society. And given that these folks take federal funds and whatnot, they're not trying to get into cannabis until they know that their other dollars are secure, and I can't afford to replace those dollars. So all of a sudden, what does that all mean? It means that research falls to us. But with the advisement of our scientific advisory board, we're able to set up real in-home use tests that are blind, where we have statistical numbers, 100 plus users. We were able to use our, we do our own delivery. So we're able to use our delivery process once we establish the participants and send them the product, allow them to have the product, and then engage in getting that research, getting those surveys filled out and drawing that data back. What we found were significant things: going to sleep up earlier, staying asleep an, up to an hour longer, and getting a better overall quality of sleep. That was across the board. Now, you know, when we account for like things like the placebo effect and whatnot, you know, we're looking for 75, 80% of folks to give us that positive sound, right? And that's what we get. In fact, in the sleep study, I think it was more in that 90 percentile that experienced definite positive effects from using this product. So that's how we do it. And this is not the first time. You know, we also did an iHut about whole, we're really passionate about proving that whole plant formulations have more efficacy than just API-based formulations. And we've engaged with that ever since Adam even showed me the first bomb. I was engaged in, you know, all kinds of other kinds of extraction methodologies. And my first thought was like, oh no, the way you scale this is you put just this extract and it's going to be fine. And it was not the same product. Those who don't know, our balm and our tinctures are green because that is real chlorophyll and plant fats. If you put it out in the sun, that greenness will go away. It's a living enzyme. That's why we believe our products are so much more efficacious. And now 7 years in, our market share in tinctures and topicals being north of 50% and dominant in this hardest market known as California, I think our products have stickiness and sell through. Now, as we translate those same values into other value added brands, we're also starting to see that same hint of like, oh, the reason why our sleep gummy is probably better than other comparable gummies on the market is because we made an emphasis to have that whole plant. Not only do we have a ratio of cannabinoids, but all that extract has other plant stuff. Like, I'm not just trying to get, even in my value-added formulations like gummies, I'm not just trying to get THC, CBD, CBN. I want plant fats. I want phytonutrients. I want some of that greenness. Now, other formulators might tell you, oh, there's bitterness, and you know, it's hard to deal with. And to that I say, do your job, get your game up. It is possible to put good whole plant medicine in formulations and also not have bitterness, right? But that probably means you need to have good farmers who did good job at their product so that you can really put it in their whole plant and accentuate the taste of cannabis and now not have bitterness. Bitterness comes from distillate and over-refining. The plant itself has sweetness. So you just need to know how to highlight that in your value-added formulation. So when you eat our elderberry sleep product, you're not only getting THC, CBD, CBN, you're getting terpenes, you're getting phytonutrients. And what you're not getting is a whole bunch of bullshit. No masking agents, no artificial flavors, no artificial colors. And it really allows the plant and that plant medicine to shine through. That is our key differentiator. And we've gone about trying to prove that scientifically.
So you've got four products focused on sleep. You got gummies, chocolates, capsules, and tinctures, right?
Correct.
So, and by the way, I should say, I disagree with the study that was done because I actually find it's 3 hours of extra sleep, not one. But either way, it's good news. But coming back to the product, so I know several of the people have recommended your products and candidly other sleep products too, and they take them. One of their first questions is, well, look, I'm taking Ambien, or tryptophan, or you know whatever else so I can sleep. This seems like, I'm just going to quote them, man. I mean nothing by this. They say, well, it seems like some sort of homeopath, you know, kind of flaky stuff, whereas I know Ambien and tryptophan are chemically proven to blah, 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 blah. How would you respond to somebody who says that to you?
You know, we can both be right, but let's just sort that out and what that means. It, look, if I was in a car accident and I needed morphine and opiates, you know, initially I would take them. If you're in a situation where your PTSD, and I don't know people's personal situation, so I don't want to, I would never disparage somebody. If you actually need Ambien, let's talk about Ambien specifically, then you need it. But you as an individual have to constantly be asking yourself, do I need it? Because there are some serious downsides associated with things like Ambien that are not associated with cannabis, right? So again, going back to the hospital situation, I believe that right now, plant medicines in general should be the front end, right? So when you go into for cancer treatment, instead of being prescribed Norcos and an antidepressant, because for those who don't know, chronic pain, especially and things like cancer, usually have a depressive effect as well as needing a pain management, right? Oh, surprise, surprise, that cannabis can do both. Usually you're prescribed an antidepressant, which takes a long time to wean off of if you ever get off it, and an opiate that can sometimes be addictive and does nothing for your nausea or your appetite. Cannabis is right there. Why not let that be the first thing? And if it doesn't work, you can always go harder. Going back to just a sleep indication, we know the drawback of addictive potential with sleep drugs, the mental fuzziness that they can give you, the blackout walking that's associated with Ambien. None of that is associated with plant-based medicine. So if you have sleep issues, like the friend you gave advice to, the first thing you should start with is this natural, non-toxic, you can call it homeopathic. Somebody wants to say that as an insult, I say to you, no. I say that's the first line of natural defense. And if it works, that's good. So if it's a doctor, hey, adhere to your Hippocratic Oath. Your Hippocratic Oath is not making money for the pharma industry. It's making sure that your folks are as well and as healthy as they can be. So why would you not offer them the non-toxic, non-addictive alternative first before you prescribe them a pill, right? Personal responsibility also comes into that. Not really, because now guess what? Cannabis comes in pills. I'm not asking people to smoke. This is not like we were in the traditional market. There are value-added products and ways of titrating cannabis that don't involve smoking or vaping, okay? So that being, we have measured doses, we have testing. So with all those new things happening, yeah, I look to my, you know, folks on the doctor side, on the lab coat side and say, really, if we're scientists together, what is the first line of defense, if not, quote unquote, homeopathic or natural plant-based medicine? Often they'll say, well, plant-based medicine is inconsistent. I'm like, 40% side effect rate and pain of death, that's inconsistent. It's not like pharma products work for everybody right off. It's not some miracle, right? We have to remember that. They are just because they're educated in telling us this, how many times do you get something from a doctor, come back 2 weeks and like, oh, I broke out in hives, I need this change, and you're down this rabbit hole. At least with plant medicine, I'm not saying it's going to work right off, but what I can tell you is that you won't have this rabbit hole of side effects. And usually with plant medicine, it's how you take it, how often you take it, and when you take it, and working and having that personal responsibility of like, I want to understand how this medicine works and incorporate it into my lifestyle. Preventative leads to cure, right? Not, oh shit, I waited, didn't do anything, lazy, and now I have a big problem. Well, you might need to start with some pharma remedy, but in your mind, again, personal responsibility, you should realize that those are like emergency type situations, and we want to abate back to something more natural. I think at Papa and Barkley, we've helped people that are on chronic pain, that were eating loads of Advil or God forbid Norcos. We start to introduce them to like a cannabis-based tincture and say, hey, start titrating this regularly, you know, in your tea. Start taking your CBD. CBD is not a miracle pill. It's like a vitamin. You need to take it every day as an analgesic, and it will eventually build in your system, lay in your fat cells and lower systemic inflammation and bring up your well-being. Educating and letting people know how to use these homeopathic medicines is that first line of defense, and we keep them healthy. That's not how the system is set up now, unfortunately.
You said an important point that I want to highlight, and I want to talk about what to take and how, et cetera. But what I found again and again and again with anybody I've recommended your products to is that they think it's going to affect them like a narcotic or an opioid or whatever, in that it's instant. Mother Nature is not instant. You know, Mother Nature has a much smarter way of behaving, because instantaneousness is often destructive, right?
And down, yep.
Yeah, you go up, you go down, or you get hives, or you're addicted, or you know, goodness, God forbid you die, or whatever. Mother Nature doesn't operate that way. It's more of this growth and this natural progression, because our bodies don't naturally respond in hours. They respond in days and weeks. And so this Ambien example I gave you, within less than a week, she had been taking Ambien for 5 years trying to get off of it. Within less than a week, she was totally off the Ambien and taking your tincture. And that's just the reality. But it took her the week to get there. And I said, you got to stick with this for two. And she did. And within a week, it was working. But it's phenomenal. And I think people need to remember that and work into it, not just expect, you know, the silver bullet.
You know, we live in a society where, one, when we think about, quote unquote, the wellness or adult use aspects of cannabis, people are like, oh, my God. One, everybody alive has been pre-programmed from day one with systemic bias about cannabis. So the first job we all need to do when we're thinking about cannabis is put aside that programming, or at least look and understand that we have a bias. Even myself, like I look at myself versus some of the younger folks, I still can't just smoke on an open street corner. But I was with one of my chief operating officer the other day, and he was like, no, we're smoking right here. And he's a little bit younger and has less shame, has been you know, more compliant years than I have, right? But my point is, that's the first thing folks need to do, is like kind of push that aside and realize, no, there was a mistake. It's like any other analgesic, and analgesics can be abused, right? Anything can be abused. So let's put that aside and talk about responsible use and what it can do. Now we're asking the right questions. And, you know, our system of medicine right now takes away personal responsibility. We've been programmed to that. We go to the doctor, they give us something, they know our bodies, they're in charge. That we're the only people that look at medicine like that. For us not to be taught to listen to our bodies, be more introspective, all things that cannabis helps, by the way, especially on that introspective piece, listen to our bodies, take that time for the medicine, natural medicines to work through, and stop looking for the one-hit wonders or the instantaneous effects or the magic pill that just done something, and realize that diet, which is all us to control, getting some exercise, which is all us to control, are the fundamental roots of health. And then when we talk about supplements or using any kinds of substances, yeah, if it works that well, it's an emergency. Like I need to be put out right now because I'm in shock, right? But anything else than that, it's not, you don't want up and then crash. You want something that it becomes part of your lifestyle. Like my wife, you know, used to tell me, it's like, stop trying to diet, change your lifestyle. Like if you want to make real change in health, you change your habits and you're going to do something forever and you need to make peace with it. Like maybe you can't drink 2 liters of soda anymore. Those days are gone. Or maybe you can't drink 12 packs of beer every night. Those days are gone as you get older and you have to say, no, it's not that I can't drink beer at all. It's just that I only need to have two. And maybe I should start to move to sugar-free drinks and, you know, less carbonated sodas or whatever it is, not for 2 weeks, not for a month, but as a lifestyle change to remove some of those harsher elements, right? That's personal responsibility. We don't need a person in a lab coat to tell us that. And surprise, surprise, they don't tell us about the things that are in our control because they make no money. You know, that there's a fear about us taking back power over our own bodies because that doesn't make outsiders more money. You know, it just doesn't.
Man, your power of over our own bodies is such an apropos comment right now. We better not go down that road, if you know what I mean.
No doubt.
We won't touch that one right now, because I know we'll share the same view. But let's talk about how to take this, right? So you got the gummies, chocolates, tincture, and capsules. Can you just take what I want people to know is, what do I take when, what should I expect, and how much of each do I take?
Yeah. So like anything, let's assume that the user is new and even has some cannabis reticence, right? They're like, ooh, I would say start with the tincture because you can start with the lowest dose. And I will always say this, go low and go slow, right? If we think about like the alcohol analogy, most of us forget when we were in high school and college, how one beer would be enough for all the friends. Then maybe it was like a six pack for the entire room. And now we bring a six pack on our own. You know, it's like there are levels to, you know, getting our sea legs, as it were. That being said, starting slow and low to never OD, to never have a bad experience is super important. We don't need people to be put off. Patience. This is a lifetime gift that you're about to get. So with the tincture, at least you can go literally drop to drop. We have a graduated, you know, measure dropper, as most tincture companies do. So, you know, even if you start less than a quarter milliliter, right, and you start to ratchet up to find what your right dose is. I would suggest in warm water in a tea, because that's the fastest way to titrate to see how it helps. You know, we're talking specifically about sleep products, but with all cannabis products, understanding that sleep is the number one side effect, take them in the evening. Do your experimentation at night when you're ready for rest, so that worst case scenario, cut right to bed for a good night's sleep. I promise people that. Things that I can say definitively and will stake my reputation and on it. Yeah, use your cannabis in the evening, worst case scenario. Even if you have THC sensitivity and you get the racy mind, take a few deep breaths. Once that racy mind abates, you're passing out. You're going to sleep and you're going to wake up tomorrow, not hungover, not pain, but probably well-rested and happy. I promise that, right? So, you know, in terms of ways of taking it, starting slow and low with the tincture is first. Once you get up to about a milliliter of that tincture, well, that's the standardized dose through all the other products, right? With the gummies, you might move to gummies next because at least you can bite that in half. You might move to the chocolate because you can subdivide the dose and kind of figure it out. But let's assume you've used the tincture. You're up to that, like, you know, 1 milligram of CBN, 4 milligrams of THC, and that's working for you. Well, now you have the gummies, you have a piece of chocolate, and you can pop one cap if you need it. And from there, as your body starts to let you know, oh, I need two of these, or one is plenty, or maybe, you know, you're a person that's just of a slighter build and only has so many kilos on their bones and has some sensitivity, and you only get to half a tincture, and perhaps the tincture is the only thing you can use, or half a gummy or half of a square of chocolate, right? But slow, low, to understand your dosage. And yes, I'm asking people to put effort in. I am not a white lab coat doctor. I'm not giving you a magic pill. I'm inviting you to participate in the magic that is cannabis, and you have to listen to your body, start titrating over days, and figure out how it's working for you. And that's it. I mean, that, you know, I wish I could say that there was like a miracle blanket answer, but it's unique for everybody. And the only way to do it is put the effort in to find the magic of this plant. But I assure you, if you put in that effort, the rewards will be profound.
So chocolate, gummy, tincture. I heard you when you said start with the tincture. It makes a lot of sense. Easiest to gauge, et cetera. Fundamentally, though, there's not one application for each product. You can use it for sleep across the board, whether it's chocolates or capsules or tinctures or whatever, right?
Yeah, you know, I will put a nuance that, you know, we are all individuals. And so some people think the gummies hit harder because their bodies process sugar and all of a sudden it hits like a punch. Some people think the chocolates are stronger because their bodies process fats and lipids in a certain way. So they think that packs a punch. So the different modalities have subtle differences. The capsules happen to be in coconut oil, so that's more like closer to the chocolate. The tinctures are in a fractionated coconut oil, but they tend to absorb submucosally, so they don't go through the GI tract. So it is possible that one of the modalities may work differently for you and better for you or something. So worth trying and figuring out where you are in, you know, how your body interacts with these different ways of taking in cannabis for sure.
Okay. Couple of quick things I want to, you threw out some big words and I'm not a smart guy. Explain sublingual for the tinctures versus, you know, digestive, going through your digestive tract.
Absolutely. So how does cannabis work? It needs to get into our bloodstream. It needs to go through our bodies to interact with the ECS system. When we smoke, it's very easy, right? We know that there's a gas exchange between the lungs that goes right into the bloodstream. So it's immediate. That's instantaneous effect. When we use an edible, we eat it, it gets digested by our bodies, and then those nutrients and such and whatever actives, just like with vitamins or Advil or whatnot, start to get released into the bloodstream and the analgesic is going through the body. With cannabis specifically, it's important to know that if you take too much, as it makes it further down the GI tract, THC will change from delta 9 to delta 11, which is a little bit more psychoactive, which is where you can get a little bit more too much in the racy head if you do too many edibles, because it's not just a delta 9 analgesic, it's actually being converted to something stronger in your gut. And for those who have like Crohn's and MS and autoimmune diseases, it's super important. That's why you see like average users, you get over 20 milligrams and they're like, how could somebody do that? But I can tell you, like working with Montel, he'll take a 500 milligram max power bar, and he has a photographic memory. He'll eat it, he'll like go through his packet and walk out on stage and start making people cry and remember everybody's names. He's eating his cannabis like any other analgesic to go to his MS. He's more afraid about tripping on stage because of his MS and his left leg degradation than he is about the cognitive ability to remember his work and engage, right? So again, we have to remember this is an analgesic. And if you have a real ailment, it will go to that ailment first. This notion of being high, it's like you can get high on opiates, but they do their job when there's the right dose, right? So getting back to, you know, how these different methods work. So when you ingest them, you know, there are, you've got to get your dosing a little bit more accurate because it's going to be in your system. And it's like, I often call edibles the gift that keeps on giving, because once it's there, it's going to keep pulsing into your bloodstream until it's done. When you smoke, the fact is, if you, you know, get into trouble and you get an adrenaline hit, adrenaline flushes into your bloodstream and there's nothing else in your lungs, you're not going to keep getting high. Not the same with edibles, right? Now, final piece of it is sublingual. What does that mean? Sublingual is yet another way to get things in your bloodstream. Obviously, sublingual means under the tongue, but some people say submucosal, which means all the soft tissue in your mouth and going down the esophagus have the potential to allow certain substances like sugar water, for instance, to seep into those things and get immediately into your bloodstream and make you feel better. That's why if you are hungover or dehydrated and they give you Pedialyte, all that is a ultra refined sugar solution so that when you're drinking it, that sugar water, that glucose is getting into your bloodstream immediately to give you that energy to bring you out. Well, with cannabis, same thing. With warm water, like I said, putting tincture in tea, even better. You're trying to get those cannabinoids to be absorbed with the water, right, into your mucosal glands and getting into your bloodstream right then and there. So you have a quicker, more rapid onset of the effect. And you also prevent the possibility of Delta 11 being produced further down the GI tract, right? So sublingual applications are just a little bit more bioavailable or quicker onset, second only to smoking. And then edibles have the longer onset time that it really is about our metabolism. There are folks who will eat a bunch of edibles and be like, it didn't work. And they forget about it, hours pass. And then all of a sudden they get like literally a cracker and their freaking guts turn on. And all of a sudden they're way high. And they're like, wait, what happened? And, you know, and it's very sporadic because if you're going to get into edibles, you have to start to understand your body, how it works. Do you take it with food? Do you take it without food? You know, are your guts working? Are they shut down? Like those kinds of things. And we're all different. So that becomes a very personal journey. Sublingual, a little bit more consistent amongst all human beings, and smoking usually also pretty straightforward in terms of that gas exchange works very similarly with most people. So we can talk about those dosings being and those effects being normalized across larger groups of people. With edibles, it becomes a little bit more personal because we all have different metabolist rates and we all metabolize different things. And some people favor, like I said, sugar versus fats in terms of how fast those things get processed and therefore how fast the efficacious product, the active ingredients are being absorbed by the bloodstream.
Yeah. So the one thing you said a few minutes ago, you said OD, and I just want to make sure everyone's crystal clear because you said it fast, that it's clear that you really can't overdose on cannabis. Yeah. You can have a bad ride, you can feel crappy, but it's not like if you took too many opioids. Yeah. And you don't want a bad ride in any way. You know, bad sleep, too high, whatever. And I've had people not listen to me, and because I give them a rule of thumb, like don't breach the 5 milligram of THC as you're beginning to learn the plant in your body and how the two react together. And I've had people take, you know, 20 and 25, and they said, this is just horrible. Well, yeah, it's horrible. It's like drinking too much alcohol, yeah. Right? But cannabis is not going to kill you and not going to cause you. Yeah.
Thank you for catching that, because I remember I said it and I was like, what I meant was exactly like doing too much so that you have a bad time. That's what I meant by OD. So thank you for qualifying it, because it is an important distinction. There have been zero reported deaths in cannabis. And I can tell you myself, I have put myself as the guinea pig. Just now, within the last 6 weeks, I judged the Emerald Cup, 240 samples. I've been in a room with folks where we got there at 10:30 and started smoking cannabis and didn't finish until 12:30 at night with literally just no official breaks. They bought lunch to us and we're just like smoking every single one of these flowers, trying to honor these farms, because we're like, everybody put in work, and like, we don't want to deny anybody the ability to like test and honor their product. And then the next day, when we go to the next category, this was the funniest thing. I wake up, we did a little retreat in a place in Ukiah, beautiful, like, you know, country with a little cabin. So I come out of my cabin, I hear some noise, and a bunch of the judges are by the hot tub. And they're like, oh, what's going on? It's like, we're smoking the winners from yesterday, pre-gaming.
Hey, Guy,
like, yeah.
I think we lost your audio.
Oh, can you hear me now?
There we go. It's back.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I was saying, you know, I see the judges over at the hot tub, and I'm like, oh, what are you guys doing smoking? I was like, we got a whole day of smoking ahead of us. They're like, yeah, we're like athletes. We're warming up, because if we start the judging on a fresh head, it won't be fair to the entrance, the entrance yesterday. I'm like, oh yeah, let's warm up. So I literally take, you know, I go back, I get my shorts, I jump in the hot tub. We're smoking, you know, everything in the Emerald Cup is a blind test, right? So all we have is the numbers. So we're like K35, S40. He's like, let me get that K35. And we're like literally pre-gaming it at 9 a.m, drinking our coffee, only to go back into a room and smoke again, right? So, and in the meantime, I'm launching kitchen. So I bought them all these edibles. So in the center of the table, there's all these edibles, right? We're trying to get through 240 samples. Now, we didn't have to smoke all 240 samples, but the winners, right? There's 5 different categories. There's top 20 in sun grown and indoor, less in the other categories. So there's a bunch of flowers to smoke. And yeah, I mean, obviously I'm a veteran. My point is, I stake everything, you know, on my mother and children that you cannot OD on cannabis like you can, let's say, alcohol. There is no alcohol poisoning version of it. There is no amount of alcohol where they're going to take you, of cannabis, they're going to take you to the ER and pump your stomach. Are they going to just ask you to calm down and take a few breaths? Yeah. And for most people, when we hear about these stats of hospitalization, it's just because they didn't have somebody to call to like put them down, right? They get paranoid. They go to the hospital, and as soon as a doctor says, hey, you're fine, take a breath, that's enough. I'll give you an even more personal example. My wife uses cannabis. We take CBD regularly every evening. For some reason, she grabbed the wrong bottle. So instead of grabbing the 30-1, she grabbed the 1-3. So here it is. She's thinking that she's up to 60 milligrams of CBD a night. So she takes 2, right? Instead of taking 60 milligrams of CBD, she ended up taking almost 50 milligrams of THC. She wakes up the next morning and swears something's wrong, right? And then at one point she says something, and I go out to the coffee table and I look and I'm like, oh. And as soon as I walk into the bedroom and I'm like, you took the wrong caps, all of a sudden nothing is wrong. And the fear and anxiety abates. She's still a little high and a little whatever, right? But she's able to then sit up. Now she's like playing with her computer. And before you know it, my wife's the kind of person that gets out of bed like at the crack, and she measures every day, vacation or not, based on how productive she was, right? That's just her thing. And that's where she finds her happiness, right? So, okay, workaholics, let's go, right? She was still able to sit in bed and be on her computer and work. So yeah, maybe she wasn't moving around as fast because she just had a lot, but this notion of being weirded out or scared was totally abated by just understanding, oh, I just took too much cannabis, right? Those are factual things that I'm saying. And I hope that folks who are listening really hear that, right? It's like, yeah, if you do too much, it's not like alcohol. You're not going to be hungover for days, and you're definitely not going to die. But to that end, start slow, understand your dose, because it only gets better, right? And once you find where you need to be, there's a lot of joy in there.
I don't know how you smoke like what you described. Because, man, I cannot. And Montel with a 500 mil, I don't know how. I feel like such a newbie lightweight. You know, me, it's 5, maybe 10 milligrams of THC. That's it. I can't go over that.
Look, I think that means you're really healthy, and that means that your mind is right, you know, because again, it is an analgesic. And if you were more stressed and if you had more need, you'd find yourself starting to consume more, you know. Yeah. It's a fact. And it's like, I find that, like, for me, I take no other medications, right? I take my CBD, I'm 50 now. I still work out actively. I still, like, you know, think I'm a younger person and whatnot. But yeah, I find that my cannabis use goes up as stress goes up. It's just that simple. And when I say it goes up, it means in order to get that same dosing, right? So when I come home after work, if it's been a stressful day, Sometimes I smoke and I walk with the dog and I come back and it's dinner time and it's amazing and it's just bliss. Sometimes I come back and it's like, I haven't even smoked that joint, right? And I'm still like after dinner, I'm still like, I got to sit on the rocking chair and smoke another one. You know what I mean? Or maybe I have to hit the Puffco peak. And that's because the stress levels are elevated, right? So again, that use, that number, it's so personal, right? And it's like, that's all that matters. It's like, if you're personally getting what you need, that's all the plant is trying to do.
Yeah. I like how you said that. That's all the plant's trying to do, because this is actually a smart plant. It's not dumb like an opioid where it has one objective, it smashes through everything and it gets it done. The plant says, oh, well, what do you need? I'll help you balance out. And right. Yeah, I'll take care of the big issue, but I'm not going to break things on the way, which I think right. opioids do.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point. Like, people need to understand the ECS system is about balance and regulation of other systems. As we're starting to understand what the ECS system is, we now realize that it is a regulatory system, right? We have our nervous system, we have our gastrointestinal system, we have our circulatory system, but what is this overarching mechanism of enzymes that's kind of trying to regulate and keep homeostasis, keep harmony amongst the other systems? That's the ECS system. We know that's where those cannabinoid receptors are. And yeah, that's what we're trying to do, balance, right? Balance and well-being. It's not about excess. And I believe in infinite joy. And so when people say to me, oh, I'm high, that means your body's in balance and allowing your mind to just experience joy and positive thoughts.
Yeah. And for clarity, for anyone listening, ECS is endocannabinoid system. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's just like the lymphatic system, the circulatory, like you said, and it's a real system. It's just because of the prohibition outlawing Schedule One, it hasn't really been studied as well as it should be. But for the audience, when you eat a mango, or why you would ever do this, but if you had, you know, edible flowers like chrysanthemums or black pepper, those all have cannabinoids feeding the ECS. The ECS is a necessary system in our bodies. We're just not very well educated on it, like we are a lymphatic or circulatory system.
Correct.
So, Guy, coming back to the sleep products, where can people get Papa and Barkley sleep products? Where, besides Three Wells, we all know, and your site, papaandbarkley.com, and we'll put the URLs up on the page. Where else can people get the products?
So in California, we're in about 85% of the dispensaries. And so if they are not carrying our sleep product, please ask your local retailer, because we do service 85% of California dispensaries. Online, we have a CBD offering. The sleep product is not there yet. I want to be honest with folks. Solventless CBN comes from THC, not CBD. So any CBN products you see on the national side are distillate-based. That is a hard guardrail in our organization not to use over-refined cannabis. However, the only time we've had internal discussions on breaking that would be to have our natural CBD formula, all natural whole plant CBD formula, with an added distillate CBN just to provide that safe access on the national market. I haven't fully approved that, but I also haven't fully shut it down. My instinct was to fully shut it down, but also safe access is a tenet of mine and Papa and Barkley. And like, if there are folks that are in states that have not yet gotten right with the world, I want them to be able to go online and order these great, awesome, efficacious sleep products. The sleep indication itself is also one that I'm sensitive to, because to your point, you know, we haven't been that harsh with some of these things, but Ambien and these other things, and even Advil PM, I'm suspect of those, and I'm desperate to provide some alternative to everybody, not just the citizens of California. So it is likely that we do something on the national side where, even though it's not my preference, we add a little bit of distillate CBN, but still give you all the other parts as whole plant goodness the way we like to, so that you can get those gummies on and capsules and so on online. But that's going to be Q4, Q1 of next year. So right now, unfortunately, if you have some issues sleeping, you can only find these great sleep products in California, in local dispensaries and delivery services and stuff like that. But that's where you can find it. And I want to provide more safe access. That is very much part of our mission.
And I know we all appreciate that. So yeah, you can go to Three Wells, and we're connected with the local dispensaries as well as the delivery. So you can start at Three Wells. So we'll, we covered so much. We could talk for days, I'm sure. But let's call it there. And this podcast will be on Three Wells YouTube, and of course at papabarkley.com. So you can find it anywhere, and you can, you know, put it on your playlist somewhere. But Guy, can't thank you enough. As always, my friend, great information. You're so articulate and deep in your knowledge. It's wonderful to talk to a guy like you. So thanks for the time and all the knowledge you imparted and shared with us.
Well, thank you for having me. It's like, it's, you know, I appreciate the platform. You know, I feel an obligation, and, you know, I think religious people would say a calling to just share these truthful messages. You know, I'm tired of the folks who share, it seems like the people with misinformation tend to have the loudest voices, and I'm determined to have a loud voice with the right information. And, you know, I will also say that, you know, at Papa and Barkley, we have this expression called best in class, which we define as if you know better, you do better. And if I've said anything inaccurate here, that's okay, because I don't look at mistakes. We don't have mistakes. We only have lessons. And so I honor folks pointing out the right thing. As a scientist, if I've made a mistake, I look at it as a benefit and a blessing for somebody to give me those corrective thoughts or that constructive criticism. So we stand open and ready to have open dialogue around real truthful science about cannabis, sustainability, and the larger greener movement that we're part of.
Well said, my friend. Well said, and I appreciate that. We'll be your megaphone. You just keep talking.
Thank you.
Thanks, Guy. Take care.
All right. Thanks.